Alberta Bertolino. Nice to meet you.
Alberta Bertolino, Jody Brockington.
Hi, how are you? Speak prior to today. Today I'm coming in from New York.
So. Oh, wonderful.
Dr. Damon Williams, ladies and gentlemen. So you'll have a seat. Thank you so very much for coming out to the Career Seekers Show.
Oh, well, I'm glad to be here and very pleased to be at the National Black MBA Conference. It's been an incredibly amazing and powerful experience.
Man, you know, about a week ago, I reached out to LaTanya and I said, look, we want to broadcast live. We want to do the Career Seekers Show live from the conference. And she was graciously willing to allow us to do that. And then when she sent me a packet of what events were going on, and yours was the first one. Like, I mean, you were at 10 o'clock, but then I saw it and I was like, oh, this is right up my alley. I'm an executive search professional. This is my thing. So I was coming to see you no matter what. It wasn't even about you being on the show. So I'm just thankful that you agreed to come on the show so we can just tell our listeners about Dr. Damon Williams, about strategic diversity leadership. And you spoke about so many great things today. I was just joking with Dr. Williams outside. He mentioned The Price is Right. Everybody that knows me knows I'm a Price is Right fanatic. But he mentions The Price is Right wheel. But you just shared so much great information. So if you want to tell our listeners a little bit about yourself.
Sure. My name is Damon Williams. And you know, I've been grinding inside this work, trying to help leaders develop themselves and trying to help organizations become more diverse for nearly 20 years. I recently stepped down from my role at the Boys and Girls Clubs of America, where I was Senior Vice President and Chief Education Officer for all the Boys and Girls Clubs around the world, and had a chance to really shape the leadership experience of the next generation of leaders. And that was after an academic career, and I've left that role, and now I'm into a new phase. And inside this new phase, I'm really looking to empower 1 million leaders and 5,000 organizations to really embrace real change and meaningful change in their lives, in their organizations, in their communities. And I invite everybody to go check out my website, www.drdamonawilliams.com, and also my tour website, www.inclusiveexcellencetour.com, mm-hmm. which really lays out all the types of things we're doing and how we're trying to help.
Excellent. Exceptional. You spoke earlier about, it kind of hit home with me because, again, you know, with the work that I do, but you spoke about not just having someone in a role, but then having equity, I believe it was, in that actual position and their ability to influence change. And that's kind of the way I read it. And if you wouldn't mind just speaking a little more, just expanding on that.
So some of my early research really focused into the role of chief diversity officers, which by the very definition are about fostering diversity and inclusion, helping new possibilities to come into play. They are change management leaders.
Yes.
Now the historic DNA of the role is one where it's been about compliance. It's been about being in step with the legal and policy arena. But in the world we live in today, diversity and inclusion is not a matter of just being in step with policy. It's about embracing the knowledge economy. It's about capitalizing diverse consumer markets. It's about really bringing in the next generation of diverse talent and maximizing the opportunity for that talent to do great things.
Yes.
So by definition, your chief diversity officer in the new economy should be a change agent. They should be an innovator. They should be helping new possibilities to happen, and they should not simply be a symbolic figurehead. They shouldn't be something that we just create as tapestry and window dressing, but rather we should be emboldening their work, not in isolation, but as a part of a broader community of change efforts to happen in an organization, and more broadly in our communities.
Yes, yes. You know, one of the tie-ins that you also mentioned, you were speaking about, you know, the segments of growth here in this country, even globally, but you made a mention of this, and it was the first time I ever really heard someone lay this out on a platform. You were speaking about, you know, of course, you know, the Latino population, but then you said the mixed race population is the fastest growing and largest segment, and I just completely overlooked that. No offense.
I've been diverse since birth.
No offense. Some of the expansiveness to some of your statements, I just found really interesting, and you know, I know Alberta is a senior recruiter at a very large organization, so she's out here and she's a certified diversity recruiter. She's kind of waving the flag as well. Mm-hmm. And Jody has came in. Jody does so much stuff, but for us, we have her do the career and health piece for the show. So we try to bring all of these different segments together, but I think at the end of the day, our platform is a career platform, but focused on a lot of diversity,
Absolutely.
Which is why we're here at an event like this.
Yeah.
So what brings you, what made this event important to you?
Why is it part of your tour?
Yes.
Yeah, well, I wanted to come here and activate, because we knew it was going to be 12,000 leaders over here. And I knew that these 12,000 leaders that would be here are the next generation of leaders that are going to help to shape what corporate America and other aspects of leadership look like. I also knew that there were leaders here that are deeply entrenched in their careers, and yet I knew that they were all coming here to get something different, and they all wanted something that could help embolden and empower their lives and their careers. And when I come to different spaces, whether it's one person, whether it's five person, or whether I'm speaking to an audience of 7 or 10,000, I want to bring it. And I knew that this was a space where I thought the message of leadership and the message of hope and the message of opportunity and personal branding and purpose-driven leadership and diversity and inclusion would be really benefited from. And I'd never been here before. And so it was a new platform for me. I hosted a webinar last week for about 2,000 leaders from around the country.
Is there a recording of that somewhere?
Actually, we did record it. Okay. We're actually going to be releasing it over time. But we're going to be doing another one. And I knew it was a new audience for me, and I knew that a lot of people would be here, and I wanted to touch with them and connect them. And it's been just a really joyful opportunity since I've been here.
Excellent.
Right. Sounds like you have enough content to have your own conference.
I probably do.
It's a lot of work. Just do the tour.
I've been at this for a long time, and I've been touring the country since 2003.
Wow.
Primarily through college and universities, and so I've visited more than 1,000 organizations, and as featured speaker, keynote, and thought leader. And in my work at Boys and Girls Clubs of America, I manage more than 350 funded corporate accounts. And so in serving our community and our clubs, more than 4,000 clubhouses. And so, that diversity of experiences, mm-hmm. whether you're talking about working with the Department of Defense, NASA, NSF, NIH, CDC, or you're talking about working with Disney, Toyota, Taco Bell, Schwab Foundation, or you're talking about working with University of Dayton, Cal State Fullerton, Miami of Ohio, Xavier University, Clemson, South Carolina,
yes.
Across the board.
And that's what I was saying. I didn't hear you today speak, but I've followed your path because I was, most of my career has been in the nonprofit side, and mostly health, nutrition, a lot of youth programming, and the urban league, which is actually how Ken and I met. But I was going to say that, I think the bigger piece of what you had to say earlier really is in that equity piece, that often this diversity role and even diverse hiring has that little extra title, but is the first thing to go, last thing thought of, and they think that they can put just a woman or someone of color in that role, and that's being diverse, but that's not that equity part, and I think that's what people who come here are really looking for, if their role, if not, some of us, as Ken was alluding to, I've been diverse since birth, so you never have to guess who's coming to dinner at my house, and I'm clear on that, but I also understand what I look like, what I supposedly represent until someone asks me, right? I end up, land in Puerto Rico and they're speaking to me in Spanish.
Yes.
I go to DR, I get the same thing. Yes. I go other places and I'm like, I'm just American, But diversity is so much more. And what you don't see in a lot of companies and organizations is the crossover. And so I just wanted to know, from your tour and your life, where do you feel there are companies doing that right? Are there some models that should be followed, do we have to really recreate it?
Yeah, that's a great question. I want to first start off kind of your lead-in, which is around the difference between diversity, equity, and inclusion. A lot of people use those words interchangeably, but the words mean something different. Right? Diversity is the big tent. It's everybody under the big tent. That's diversity. Equity, we're talking about different types of groups and the type of outcomes that we're producing. We're trying to close gaps. We're trying to bring women to another level of leadership and participation. We're trying to bring African Americans to another leadership and participation, Latinos, so on and so forth. We're trying to get equity of outcomes. When we talk about inclusion, we're asking the question, how does each and every one of our citizens and our organizations and our communities feel a sense of belonging and connectedness and a sense of health in those spaces, whether they're LGBTQ, whether they're black, whether they're brown, whether they're rich, whether they're poor, how do we bring them together? So, we use those terms interchangeably, but they're actually quite different, diversity, equity, and inclusion. And we wrote about that in Strategic Diversity Leadership. But in terms of your question, one of the things I don't do is I generally try not to name names for different reasons.
Well, maybe more industries, not that it has to be a specific, but
sure.
I feel like I can always say there's a poor succession planning across every every industry. I don't care when there's nobody doing it right. Yeah. Right. So, but I'm saying, is there a place?
Read about like, the Diversity 100.
Right.
Diversity
yeah.
Inc. Right.
Or,
no,
what, and Damon spoke about that this morning.
The matrix to get through what those.
Right? Yeah, exactly. Methodology.
You know, yeah, those some of those ranking systems. You know, a couple of things. One, I appreciate the work that Diversity Inc. does and others do to try to bring some visibility and attention to the work of diversity inclusion and creating an external narrative that helps to legitimate the work you're doing internally. Right? Let me say that again.
Yeah, repeat that. Yeah. Someone's going to say, "What did he say?"
An external narrative. So when you've got publication like Diversity Inc. saying that X company is doing great or Y company is doing great, what that does is that puts new energy in the world that then those leaders that are trying to get diversity and inclusion work done in company X or in company Y can take that energy that comes with that press release, that comes with that award, that comes with that letter, that comes with being on that podium, that comes with being listed in that publication, and they can then marshal that to get more work done internally. Right? So it's taking the external to internal and really manifesting it to move your agenda forward. At the same time, too, what do those rankings really mean? Because if you start talking to individuals in those organizations, they may say, well, you know, we still feel like we're catching hell every day. We still feel not included, or we still are dealing with the same type of glass ceiling effects, or with women and women of color, maybe not glass ceilings, but I mean concrete ceilings, right? Where you can't not just see through, but you can't even put your hand through to nothing, right? So you got all those dynamics that play themselves out that I believe are really, really important. When I look across the various different sectors, right? Higher education, government, corporate, not-for-profit, K-12, everybody's struggling. Everybody is struggling. Everybody's trying to get something done. I think you've got some pockets of excellence, right? In a sector, some pockets of excellence where certain organizations are doing great work. But largely, I think that we've got a lot more effort, work to do. And it's why I created the Inclusive Excellence campaign, inclusiveexcellencetour.com. It was really to embolden leaders to use more evidence-based practice, right? Practice that's been validated by research, practice that's been validated by other organizations, practices that maybe are coming out of the change in organizational transformation literature, and we're bringing them into the diversity work, you know, and so evidence-based practices, I think the next generation, because not that we haven't done things, we haven't done them with enough rigor, discipline, and focus relentlessly over time.
You know, so it's the Career Seekers Show, and I was thinking back through some of the things that you spoke about earlier today that an individual could take with them and say, this is how I get better. And you said that everyone should have an executive coach. Can you elaborate a little more on that?
Absolutely. So
we'd like some new clients.
Right. So I'm a big believer that in a couple ideas. One is the work of Lars Anderson, who wrote the book Peak, which is a book on peak performance, right? So this is a guy who studies expertise. So how does Serena become Serena? How did Michael Jordan become Michael Jordan? How did Oprah become Oprah? How did Jobs become Jobs? How did iconically successful people become those iconically successful people? Whether you're iconically successful and we know about you, or you're the young person who won the Spelling Bee, or you're the young person who became a world-class cellist or video game player, how did that person become that? When you start to really crack into the science of excellence, there's a couple ideas that stand out. One, individuals that are excellent are really intentional and focused in what they're doing, right? They're purposeful, they have a goal, and they have clarity in that goal. The second thing for individuals that are really building out their expertise is they spend 10,000 hours not just practicing. See, Malcolm Gladwell, in his book, The Tipping Point, talked about 10,000 hours of engagement. That was a misinterpretation of Lars' work. The real interpretation of the work is not 10,000 hours of engagement. The real interpretation is 10,000 hours of intentional practice against your deficit area, right? So it's the thing you don't do well.
Where
you're challenged. So when you're studying for the SAT or the GRE, you know, one of the things that we talk about is don't just do the practice examples, do practice tests. Then analyze what you did and didn't do well in the practice test, and then focus with great energy and intention and on the places where you didn't do well. So it's focus and intentionality, it's deliberate practice in the areas in which you're not strong. And the third aspect of great expertise is coaching. You've got to have a third party that helps you to be focused into the opportunity areas, gives you a place to make meaning and to thought partner on how we get better, helps you to develop a plan. And so I'm a huge believer in executive coaching. I'm a huge believer in peer-to-peer coaching. It always doesn't have to be a professionalized relationship. And let's be real, some folks don't have the money or the resources to hire a coach, but that doesn't mean you don't, that you have to forego having a coach, right? Someone can be your coach without having that title.
Well, it's having that cheerleader, and I'm also going to say that goes back to your Boys and Girls Club days, of, you know, someone besides yourself that believes in you, right? Mm-hmm. Whether it's a teacher, a coach, an actual executive coach, someone else who's going to push you and hold you accountable when you can't.
That's exactly right.
You know, so I'm part of the Forbes Coaches Council, right? So I do some career coaching and things of that nature. But what I found was really interesting, and it's something you spoke on today. So there's this platform. We live in a world now where we have a platform, let's just say YouTube or whatever it may be, where you can get, this is something Dr. Williams spoke of earlier today. He doesn't necessarily know Steve Jobs. Mm-hmm. However, he listens to him frequently. He doesn't know Barack Obama. However, he listens to him frequently. I think he said he's listened to all of Barack Obama's content that's on YouTube. And you said something really interesting because you said something in regards to Black African-American females and the way they consume this material on YouTube. And you said they're the largest consumers of social media, but it's mostly for entertainment purposes. But there are so many platforms with great information and educational material that people can leverage to kind of advance themselves and advance this conversation. Is there anything that you would share with someone and say, hey, these are people you might want to kind of start being familiar with, or people you might want to follow, or anything like that?
Yeah. The first one I would say is, go join Dr. Damon A. Williams' YouTube channel. Of course. You know, we need you in that channel.
That one was
see that? You see that love?
Yeah. We caught it. Three of us will
we got 21 videos in the channel so far. We'll add more. We had my commencement speech I gave to the graduating class of the University of Michigan, the speech entitled Make America Great for All. We've got content that I delivered to 4,000 teens around character and leadership development. We've got content there about diversity, equity, and inclusion strategy. We'll have more content. I'm sitting on a treasure trove of information that we'll be uploading soon. And so one thing I would say is to go there. But beyond my work, some individuals that I take from, and, you know, the thing I talk about is learning relationships. We can have powerful learning relationships with so many folks. And so I draw inspiration from those learning relationships. So who are some of those individuals? I draw inspiration from a relationship with Steve Jobs. I draw information from the relationship I have with Jim Collins, author of Good to Great. I draw inspiration from the relationship that I have with Magic Johnson, who has, you know, done amazing. I draw inspiration from the relationship I have with Arnold Schwarzenegger, who's done more and accomplished more than Arnold, who came to this country as an immigrant with an accent so thick he could barely speak. He became the greatest bodybuilder the world had ever seen, reaching the peak of physical human perfection. He then doubled down on that success, became the biggest movie star in the history of movies. When the world told him he was too big and that the stars were Dustin Hoffman and the stars were Al Pacino and it was the little guy, and they told him that his accent was too thick. But if the accent wasn't so thick, then would he have gotten the part of the Terminator where he had to sound like a machine?
Sure.
If his body wasn't so developed, would he have gotten the part of Conan? Because they needed someone who was the peak perfect of human perfection. And so you hear those stories, and those stories not just of his work, you know, in the space as a bodybuilder, but I think the work that he's done and the work of being a politician and community building and infrastructure building. And, you know, he created more after school programs than any governor in the history of the state of California, helping vulnerable kids and communities. And so when you look at that success, you can learn from it, you can use from it. Kobe Bryant, Les Brown, Tony Robbins, E.T., all these individuals I draw inspiration from, Zig Ziglar, Simon Sinek, Seth Godin. I have literally 100 different podcasts that I've had on my MP3. And I did say MP3, I went old school.
I was like, if Tiffany was here, our other co-host, she
I went back to the island, and I listened to that content constantly, and this is the reason why. We have to program our mindset for greatness. And you can't program your mindset for greatness absent seeing greatness. You have to see greatness, you have to experience greatness, you have to pursue greatness. Pursuing greatness is an act of doing. It is not a spectator sport, right? Whether you're talking about the great athlete, whether you're talking about the great performer, whether you're talking about the great orator, whether you're talking about the great leader, whether you're talking about the great inspirer, whether you're talking about the great change agent, it's a doing game. But yet we get frozen in our minds and our heads and we don't go. One of the ways you help you to hit go is to listen to folks who have hit and to learn from greatness. And that is the beauty of the 21st century. And that's the beauty of what I wanted all of our Boys and Girls Club youth to know, is don't view the social space, the digital space, as simply a sphere for entertainment, but view it as a space for finding your pathway to greatness and clarifying your why, right? Everybody knows what they do. Some know how they go about it. Those who are great and inspire have a deep sense of their why, and their why has energy, their why has magnetism, their why pulls greatness toward them.
Exceptional. How do our listeners get in contact with you?
Yeah. I would ask everybody in the sound of my voice, please go check out www.drdamonawilliams.com. You can go to the site. You can get access to my to videos, to resources and tools. You can reach out to me. You can find ways to bring me to your environment, to lecture, to mentor, to get down. You'll also find out more about my forthcoming webinars and where I'll be appearing. We've got 20 locations booked around the country already, and we know there'll be more. I've got lots of things in store, and at the end of the day, I'm a servant, and I respond to every email.
Wow, great.
I respond to every email.
You know, I know you got to run. I want to let you go, but I want to speak about one thing.
Yes, sir.
When you mentioned earlier that, and this is where you were speaking about the wheel, but you mentioned that you made a decision to move forward and do some different work. And in 6 weeks, you were able to book 20, I believe, tour dates.
Yeah.
How empowering is that in letting you know this is what I was supposed to do? Like, where's that take you?
It's very emboldening. And this is the thing. Whenever we move forward with something and you start taking steps and start walking, there's a point when you jump and you start falling. And the question is, how long does it take for your parachute to open? Mm-hmm. And when you jump into something else and you're falling, you see all these people soaring. The question is when your parachute is going to open. Now, some are going to have to fall further down before their parachute opens up. Those individuals who parachute opens first, very quickly, what that is telling you is that, number one, the moment is right for what you're doing. Number two, it is opportunity meeting preparation, which opens that parachute, right? Opportunity meeting preparation that opens it up. Seth Godin, the author of Tribes, talks about this. In the world, there are individuals who like what you like, believe what you believe, understand what you understand. The question is, can you find them? With the digital tools that we have available to us, you can reach your tribe. As I am on this webinar, there is a tribe of individuals who are coming to this, and you are leading them in this pathway of self-discovery and leadership development. So the world has tribes looking for leaders. When you start speaking to your tribe, and if you have put the foundational work in that you're giving to them, you don't have to yet. All you have to do is whisper. And when you whisper, the world responds. And so what's happening now is not what I've done in the last 6 weeks. What's happening now is the manifestation of what I've done in the last 10 years. It's the 30 publications. It's the 1,000 organizations on the grind. It's doing the things I did at Wisconsin, at Connecticut, and at Michigan, that Boys and Girls Clubs of America, and it's being a servant. See, that's the thing, particularly with the millennial generation, the centennial generation, and even individuals, just they see the instant gratification that is possible because of the digital world. But see, likes is not trust.
Yes.
Let me say that again. Likes is not trust. You might have 10,000 likes, but that doesn't mean they trust you. You know, when someone trusts you, there's a promise that's been made and a promise that's been kept that's founded in something authentic and good. So when 2,000 people came to my webinar, they were saying, Damon, we trust what you're talking about. We want to be a part of this narrative. We want to be a part of this journey with you. Not because you're great, but because the issues and the why of what you're talking about is compelling to us. And that is the thing I try to talk about when I coach and I talk to folks. you know, a lot of people want to be on the platform, but will you put the work in to make yourself worthy of the platform? So many folks talk about, you know, I'm a motivational. I'm not a motivational speaker. I'm an educator. You know, but I'm an educator whether I'm talking to a group of club kids in the middle of nowhere, or I'm an educator when a group of students hunts me down after I've given a talk, or I'm an educator when I'm on the stage for 5,000 people. I'm an educator. Today, they were putting my title up, you know, when you don't have a big title anymore, they're like, he's no longer with this organization, what are we calling? I said leader, scholar, educator, because that's what I am, because that's my identity, that's my brand, leader, scholar, educator, whether I'm on this platform or that platform, doesn't really matter, that's what I am and that's what I do.
Outstanding, outstanding. Pick up the book, Strategic Diversity Leadership, Dr. Damon A. Williams at the Career Seekers Show. 106.5 FM in Philadelphia, streaming live at phillycam.org. We do this every Wednesday from 4 to 5. I wish we could have this gentleman every Wednesday. Thank you so very much for coming up, sir.
Thank you.
Yes, indeed. Latonya, thank you for making this happen.
Thank you. So catch the tour. You're not in Philly. You've already missed his 2 seminars. But catch the tour. It's worth every moment.
We're part of the tribe now, man. You got something special.
I appreciate you.
I'll send you an invite on LinkedIn.
You just educated me.
And how do I get access to
this? I would like to have you on my digital career success series with the National Urban.
Let's do it.
So let's pick a topic for sure.
Yeah, I'll get it to Latonya.
Thank you so much, Latonya, for everything.
My man. Thank you, brother.
Listen to me.
Yeah,
thank
you. We're still live.
Yeah. It's the Career Seekers Show. Dr. Damon A. Williams, unbelievable. Wow. Saw this gentleman earlier today.
Can't even, you know, he speaks and you just can't talk.
He's
got so much to tell us.
He has so much information to share.
But he's also saying things that we've talked about.
Yes.
You know, it's validation around.